WhiskyCast. Proudly brought to you by Redbreast, the definitive single pot still Irish whiskey. Join the stillhouse at singlepotstill.com and receive an exclusive whiskey tasting journal.
John Glaser's Compass Box whiskies often come with unusual names: Hedonism, Peat Monster, Asyla, just to name a few. You won't find Stags, Tartans, or any of the other icons of Scotland, even though his Scotch whiskies are as Scottish as any other. Except, of course, for the original spice tree, Glaser came up with the idea to add an inner layer of French oak staves to the barrels spice tree was vatted in. In 2006, the Scotch Whisky Association decided that violated the Scotch Whisky Law's mandate that only traditional practices could be used to make Scotch whisky, and threatened to go to court. Facing a long and expensive fight, he withdrew Spice Tree.
Our point of view was, we're doing something that is, you know, using inner staves in a used whiskey barrel is an evolution of the traditional practice of maturation, of oak maturation of Scotch whiskey. And we're using a quality of oak that no one else in the industry, as far as we know, uses, and it's making a whiskey that's quite compelling in character. So this should be a good thing, just simply from a quality perspective. We just didn't see eye to eye on that.
The best thing that may have ever happened to you and to Compass Box was the whole spice tree controversy to you guys, because it put you on the map, and the publicity from it helped get you more attention as this maverick blender with these great ideas, or unusual ideas, challenging the old guard of Scotch whiskey. And all the success has come since then. A lot of the success has come since then. And I'm thinking that whole thing might have been the best thing that ever happened to you.
Well, I think it has, the whole spice tree situation with the Scotch Whisky Association all those years ago has helped for some people to define what we're about and the way we think. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I would agree that it was an important episode in our history. But at the end of the day, we were just doing what we thought was the right thing to do to make better whiskey.
John and his team eventually came up with a similar method using toasted French oak barrel heads that satisfied the SWA and brought Spice Tree back several years later. But that process of evolution still drives Compass Box in the search for the perfect blend. In 1907, O. Henry wrote about two men trying to recreate that perfect blend. His story, The Lost Blend, decorates the glass walls of John Glaser's office and the label of Compass Box's new whiskey.
O. Henry was a great chronicler of bars and drinking in America in the very early 1900s, and this is one of his sort of classic stories around takes place inside a bar where these two guys are trying to recreate this blend of spirits that they had accidentally put together, which had almost magical powers. And as they're frantically trying to put the thing together, meanwhile, the real story is about the bartender falling in love.
Why does it speak to you so much?
Well, it's our business, it takes place in a bar, and I always envision this as taking place in Pete's Tavern in Manhattan, which was close to where I used to live in Manhattan, so I know Pete's Tavern really well. I know Henry was said to have lived nearby and was said to have done writing in today's Pete's Tavern back when he lived in New York, and it's about our business. It talks about a bar. This is 1907, we believe it was published, a bar with all the spirits that it has on the back bar. They make cocktails there. And it's about two guys trying to recreate a blend. So it speaks to me on a number of different levels.
In part one of our interview with John Glaser, he answered a few questions from WhiskyCast listeners, but his fans have many more questions.
One of our questions comes from Grant Steveley in British Columbia, who wants to know if you use a whiskey vaporizer in your blending process.
By whiskey vaporizer, is he talking about the bulbous...
I believe so, yes.
Thing, and if so, we've played with it.
if this is what he's talking about, but we don't use it on a regular basis. For me, what's important is I think we can get under the skin of whiskey by the approaches we take, and nosing stuff in terms of cask assessment at cask strength, and then reducing it. And we'll reduce down to 20%, which is typical for blenders in Scotland, to really get an understanding of what you've got there. But when we're doing blend prototypes that we would bottle, it's always understanding what the whiskey is presenting at, what the bottling strength will be, and then always adding water. And I do that in stages, and even down to 20%, which no one will really typically ever drink whiskey at 20%, but I'll bring it down there just to understand what's really in it. All these are things that I think are probably getting at the same thing that the vaporizer idea is about, if I'm understanding the mm-hmm. question correctly, which is just understanding all the components locked into that spirit.
Graham Brown has a question. He wants to know, can we have the General too?
if you can source those, find those whiskeys for us, whiskeys of that character, of that nature, I'd love to do 2, 3, 4, and 5. Yeah. So the General was, that's one of those limited releases. Limited releases for us can be inspired by lots of different things. Sometimes they're made for an occasion or a person, like when we did Delilah's and we did Mike Miller's whiskey a couple of years ago and sold that around the world for his 20th anniversary. Sometimes something like Flaming Heart and even Hedonism Maximus, which we hope to bring back again, are ideas that we can only do when we're able to get the appropriate casks, and they tend to be kind of special. But the General is the kind of limited edition that we enjoy doing, because it's just this, it's a discovery. It's serendipity very often, talking to so-and-so and finding out that they've got these casks that they don't have anything to do with, any reason to keep. And so it was a broker, and it was an independent bottler, and they both had these cask-aged blends, one with a minimum age of 33, one with a minimum age of 40. And they've been blended, put back into wood for decades, and turned into these just awesome, compelling, extraordinary, complex blended Scotch whiskies.
Right.
And I was originally wanted to bottle them each individually, but it was talked out of that by the guys here in the office. Hey, we're blenders. And so Greg and I worked on a way to blend them together, and they became the General. I'd love to do it again, but gosh, don't know if we'll come across just, half a dozen, 8, 10 casks like that kicking around in somebody's warehouse anytime soon.
Lauren Mulder had an interesting question. He wants to know, what's the smallest amount of whiskey that you've ever used as a component in one of your blends?
The smallest amount you ever would have used as a percentage. Well, right off the top of my head, it's probably the last batch of Flaming Heart, which we released in 2012. Where we were, for that batch, different than the previous, we were trying to work in a small amount of sherry cask-aged malt, just to add another layer of complexity and a bit of fatness on the palate, while maintaining the Flaming Heart character that we kind of set up in the first three bottlings over the years. And I was originally thinking, it might be around 5% or something like that of the final recipe, because we'd sourced some lovely old sherry cask-aged malts. In the end, long story short, that was way too much, 5%. In the end, it was 0.7% of the final recipe, which was this sherry cask-aged malt. But, any more than that, and it was showing its face too much. It was throwing off the balance of characters that made it Flaming Heart.
Ivan Stoller wanted to know if you've ever considered using an American whiskey in one of your blends, or doing a blended whiskey from America, or maybe working with rum or some other kind of spirit. I got to think not, because your specialty is Scotch whiskey.
Yeah, there's just so much. What we say to people is that when you look across all the grain whiskeys just that are produced in Scotland and all the malt whiskeys that are currently produced, let alone what one could do with grain whiskey and malt whiskey if you took a different approach than the distillers typically take today, that's another question. But when you look across the spectrum of whiskey available from Scotland today, there's more spectrum of style than any other spirit type in the world. So we've got a lot to play with, and so I have not been tempted to do anything seriously with those kinds of spirits. The only thing that we almost did, and I wish we could have, was 5 or 8 years ago, we thought we were sourcing some great Japanese malts, and we were all ready to bottle those as a special thing, but then they slipped away from us.
John Glaser has become a role model for other whiskey makers. In his new book, American Spirit, James Rodewald writes about the influence of Compass Box on American craft distillers who want to create the American Compass Box.
That is very flattering, absolutely. Yeah, that's really nice of people to say stuff like that. But do they have to have their own distillery to do it? Because we don't.
Right.
But of course, to clarify, you know, this is the tradition in Scotch whiskey. Mm-hmm. Blenders don't always have distilleries
right
at their disposal. But yeah, as I said, 15 years ago is a long time when you look at the world of spirits, and it was a totally different world back then. It wasn't as, you know, spirits wasn't cool, weren't cool. Whiskey was not cool. Scotch was struggling, not everywhere in the world, but certainly in North America and Western Europe. Things change, and you know that's a hugely important lesson, I think, for people getting into this world of whether it's spirits or wine, the world of drinks, where it's heritage. So much of the world of drinks is so encumbered by heritage and tradition. It's people think, but in fact, traditions do change and evolve over time. People think everything's always been the same. You know, all that marketing mumbo jumbo about single malts. So, you know, we made this single malt the same way for 150 years. Bullshit. You know, things have changed. You know, the way they fire this, so many things have changed. Sometimes change is incremental, and so, you know, you don't notice it for many, many years. And sometimes change is in leaps, but things do change. Traditions do evolve when we learn new things, new ways of doing things. And people's attitudes and perceptions change.
How much longer will John Glaser continue to change those perceptions? Unsolicited offers come in every once in a while, but the answer has always been no.
I started this business because I saw an opportunity to make a difference in our industry, in the Scotch whiskey industry. And in my old role, you know, I had all the marketing money, you know, as a team, we had all the marketing money in the world at our disposal. But to me, I thought breaking away and doing my own thing, I'd be able to make more of a difference. And, like, you know, for all sorts of reasons, I just thought a small business, people are going to listen to the arguments of a small business more readily than a big brand, because of course the big brand's going to. So that was an important thing for me, was the feeling I could make a difference. And that's why I got into it, to make a difference and to share, as it, you know, says up on the wall of the office here, to share the joys of great whiskey, great Scotch whiskey, with more people in the world. And I love what I do, and I've always set the business up, and the guys around here can tell you, you know, set the business up to have a strong foundation, so it can be an enduring business that I can be a part of until one day when I don't want to work anymore, you know. And I love the fact that my boys, Josh and Zach, 10 and 13 right now, they love what I do. And so Josh talks about, you know, can I go one day, can I live in California and work for Compass Box for you? And Zach talks about, like, building with his bricks. He's like, I'm building a distillery, Dad. And so, hey, you know, if one day they want to come and work for the business, that's the best thing for them. Fantastic. Yeah, I mean, if we're building something of value. So if one, I would never wouldn't rule out that if a business came to us and said, look, we can help you achieve your mission more readily and allow you to stay involved, I'd be a fool not to listen to that. And we have had people come and say that, but their arguments haven't been compelling enough to us. We haven't necessarily believed that they could do better than we can do on our own. So I'm quite happy being an independent company.
John, thank you again for doing this. It's a pleasure.
Yeah, real pleasure for me.
For more Cask Strength conversation on whiskeys with the people who make them and the people who drink them, join us each week for WhiskyCast. In London, I'm Mark Gillespie.